Hi, I'm a terrible thing, and welcome back for the final part of 6 Days of Sacrifice, the Chozo Mythos. Let's just quickly go over what we learned in the last episode. So, apparently, this facility was built around the remains of the Defoe Manor. And John Defoe, his mind is trapped inside the ruins and are sort of like leaking into Janine and controlling her. That's why she's so afraid of Trilby. And that the Trilby clones were created as a way to ward against the spirit of John Defoe escaping. The question is, why is the prince killing the Trilby clones? It's a good question. Also, why are we here? Why aren't we dead? Why did the cult leave us alive? Well, in this episode, we're going to find out. Okay. Try calling Janine. No reply. That's not good. Canning. I literally have no idea how to open it. Also, it would appear that our dream about murdering Canning was not just a dream. It's Canning's blood. I know it is somehow. It splattered all over the cell. So was that him we just heard yell out? Janine? What you doing, girl? Looks like she's been taken over completely by John. That's weird. Slip past her? Oh boy. When I touch it, pins and needles run up my arm. When I pick it up, it doesn't seem to have any weight at all. I think I just picked up a memory. Down the hallway. Change camera. 5. Screen has no controls. Is there another way to open the... So how do I get the door open? All right. Sleeping quarters. No, other way. But there's more of the facility that's changed into the Defoe Manor House. Right, here we go. Okay. I guess I have to wait for her to get closer. It hurts. Fair enough. All right, here she comes. Remember your old home? Oh, crap. Janine! No. Yeah. Day 5. February 3rd, AD 2386. This, of course, is our resident celebrity. The Mephistopheles killer? Yes, you'll remember it was all over the news. Last year, the EFS Mephistopheles was relaunched with a skeleton crew of 6. The appointed ship's counselor was one Dr. Jonathan Somerset. And he reported for duty punctually and on schedule. Unfortunately, shortly after the launch, it was discovered that the real Dr. Jonathan Somerset was dead. Pushed down a flight of stairs, presumably by the imposter who had taken his place. Off-world security was dispatched to intercept the Mephistopheles. Its last recorded communication was an SOS distress call to the EFS Charisma. By the time off-world security arrived, this man had slaughtered the entire crew. So who is he? His name is Malcolm Somerset, the only son of Dr. Jonathan Somerset. He was a student of psychology at Ganymede University, wanting to follow in his father's footsteps. But he failed the final examination and dropped out. It seems becoming a shipboard counselor was his dream. And when his father was called up, he couldn't hold in his jealousy. So why did he kill the Mephistopheles crew? That's partly why he remains under psychiatric study. It's a complete mystery. His profile is completely inconsistent with a spree killer. The best theory we have is that he found out and killed out of desperation. But that doesn't explain the demented creativity. The sheer bloodthirsty relish with which his crewmates were slaughtered. One man was impaled, another was blinded. The first officer had her head twisted right around. Many of the corpses were dismembered and stitched randomly together into Frankenstein-like monstrosities. Certainly not the actions of a man simply trying to cover up a far less serious crime. But let's leave him for a moment and move on. We can end. I love this part. So now, we're Malcolm Somerset. I didn't say that all 6 days were the days in that particular week. This day takes place far in the future. But I am going to save it here because there is a known glitch that happens with the game sometimes, and I don't know what triggers it, but if it happens, then I'll be able to go back and edit that part out. You. I was beginning to think you'd gone forever. This shall be our last meeting. You'll get me out of here, right? You owe me at least that. What makes you think I owe you anything? You're the one who made me kill my father. I only encouraged you to do what you already intended. You promised me I wouldn't get caught. You wouldn't have been caught had the Mephistopheles left that locker alone. You knew about that? Did you know about John Defoe? Was it all part of some plan? I did not scheme it. But I did know it would come to pass. All I did was encourage events to happen as I have seen. You know they think I did it. All that senseless murder. I've been locked up here for 6 months. I don't care about you or any of your bullshit. Just get me out of here, and you'll never hear from me again, I swear. I very much doubt that. But rest assured, I am here to release you. Thank you. What do I have to do? Just use the key and leave by the door. What? Maybe you haven't noticed, but the lock is on the outside. Besides, the guards outside will... I'm not talking about that door. Yeah. What are you talking about? What door? What key? Who are you? And our package just arrived. Someone sent me a parcel with no return address. It contains some kind of oddly shaped knife, but the feel of it, it's old enough to be an antique. It's some kind of ancient knife, but with teeth on the end like a key. Freehorn's blade. And the door he meant is this one. A door made of flesh. Very Hellraiser. You know what? I'm going to save it again here, because this is actually the part where the glitch happens, so. Stairs. Lots and lots of stairs. I think there's an SCP like this. The further down you go. Okay. Barry? I don't know. Okay. I'm definitely reliving those murders. But each time it's John Defoe. And I'm getting covered in blood. And my hair is falling out. Oh. Are now red. looks like the corpse of an old man in the remnants of a suit, tied up with the strands of muscle and skin. Where I come from, blanking people is considered rude. You're alive? Of course. Jizo will not let me die. Who are you? You ask a complex question. The name by which I know myself is Trilby, but I strongly suspect that I'm not the original. I'm probably a clone, given over to Jizo as a plaything. Or perhaps that is my arrogance talking. Perhaps I simply cannot bear the thought that the real me would ever be imprisoned like this. What is this place? I knew you'd ask that. No one who knew that this place was would ever come here voluntarily. You're inside the body of Jizo. How did I get here? The last I knew, I was in an asylum. On Earth? In the universe of technology? Then I can't explain it. There's no possible way to get from there to here. Not corporeally, anyway. Who's Jizo? A more appropriate question would be, what is Jizo? Or even, where is Jizo? Since it seems he's a place as well as a fiend. But to answer you, Jizo is a pain elemental. There were once many of his kind in the universe of magic, small and largely harmlessly creatures that fed on petty anguishes of others. But over time, they became more and more reliant on magic, until their actual physical bodies were all but completely vestigial. They fought for more power by killing and absorbing each other. Jizo is the very last of his kind. A bloated mountain of gristle whose very essence crackles with residual magic. And now, nothing but the most hellish torments will sate his hunger. He's the closest thing to a god of pain. You're the one who sent the idol into space. Possibly. Certainly I have memories of doing so. And you must be the man who found him. How could you know that? After the hotel, Trilby spent many years researching Jizo. He requested a vision of the idol's future from the Ministry of Occultism. He was well respected by them, and his request was granted. Whether I'm the original or not, I do possess memories of that vision. I saw you. I saw what Defoe did to you. I saw what you became. And I realized that I'd seen you before somewhere. But never mind. You want to redeem yourself, don't you? More than anything. Then all you have to do is follow my instructions. What do you want me to do? I want you to kill me. And don't pretend you're a stranger to killing. You have Freehorn's blade. It's infused with Jizo's magic. It's the only thing that can release his hold on me. I want you to drive it into my heart. The nature of the blade will infuse you with energy. Call it my soul, my life force. We don't have a proper name for it. I want you to give it to the one who needs it. Who? You'll find him nearby. He isn't physically here, but Jizo is observing him, so he manifests. My life force will still save him wherever his actual body is. I won't kill you. I'm gonna bust you out of here. No. Even if you could, I have no place to go. To the pain elemental, time is non-linear. It sees the past, present, and future all at once. Were I to leave this place, I would end up at any moment in time. Or even every moment. Or no moment at all. It's the reason why you and I are able to interact like this. Despite, from my perspective, being in the 21st century. And you in the 24th. Now kill me. Both our destinies demand it. Wait here. Don't leave me. I'm sorry. None of this was your fault. Remember that. It doesn't look like his heart. It's more like he stabbed him in the stomach. Remembering Trilby's notes? Uh-oh. So you felt that, did you? I think I should get out of here. I don't think Giselle liked that very much. Who's that? Yo, I'm out, peace! Yep, I'd say he's dead. Damn it. We're gonna catch hell for this, aren't we? Why'd he have to cut his own throat out? Couldn't he have just hung himself with his pajamas like most of them do? It's like he knew we'd have to clean up the mess. Personally, I'm more worried about how he got hold of a knife. You and I both know, if a freak really wants to kill himself, there's very little we can do to stop them. Can you honestly say he doesn't deserve it? I've got a little brother, just joined the Navy Medical Corps. Same age as that poor doctor on the Mephistopheles was. I can assure you right now, that's not how Dr. Laszlo sees it. Come on then. Let's fetch a body bag. So yeah, Malcolm killed himself. Blackness swallows me. The furious roar of Giselle fades from hearing. I am free. Free of that place. Free of physical form. The ebb and flow of time flutters against what passes for my body, caressing me like a lover. When I was a man, I was destiny's prisoner. Now, I will be her servant. There are men and women who must be guided. I will be the caretaker. Very weird, but very cool. And it didn't glitch, which is great. Day 6. July 28th, AD 2189. Could not have saved her, Dekab, but there's still enough time to save yourself. What happened to her? Her weakened defenses allowed John Defoe to crush her personality. In loving her, you tainted her. Tainted? What's that supposed to mean? Just as the past affects the future, so too does the future affect the past. And your future, Dekab, is a dark one indeed. So dark that its influence travels backward through your lifetime, leaving an eternal blemish on your soul that worsens as your fate draws near. Shut up. Why can't you ever give me a simple, straight answer? Why won't you help me get out of here? You'll find the way out of the basement of Defoe Manor. In the basement of Defoe Manor, whatever. What if you wish to escape? Go there. You expect me to go down into that madhouse? What about John Defoe? Enough clones of Trilby remain to provide an escort. They'll buy you time you need to break through Defoe's defenses. But you must combat the corrosive influence of his mind on equal footing. Know him. Become him. Defeat him. We shall not meet again. I wish you luck. Wait. Will you at least tell me who you are? Once, I was a man. John Defoe destroyed all I had. But a gift gave me the power to see the destiny of all mankind, while simultaneously enslaving me to it. You and I, Dekab, are pawns in a game too vast and complex to understand. But a pawn that crosses the board becomes a king. Or at the very least, a prince. Freehorn's blade is one of the Order's most sacred relics. It is said to have been used by the 18th century prophet Jack Freehorn himself to deliver the 12 sacrifices that enabled him to write the Books of Chazoe. When a person dies, their body, mind, and soul separate and drift apart. An individual killed by Freehorn's blade, however, separates differently. They leave their body behind, while the mind and soul remain together. This results in a non-corporeal shift, This results in a non-corporeal spirit of unusual ability, capable of strong manifestations, but they remain forever under the command of the one who wielded the blade. An individual can exploit a loophole in these rules by killing themselves with Freehorn's blade, which would theoretically, I need to go to sleep, transform them into an immensely powerful spirit, a magic-infused force of pure will. None, however, have yet chanced this. Well, now they have. So now, according to Malcolm, the way out is through the basement of the Defoe Manor. I don't know why I went the long way. But now this place really looks like the dungeon. And the door to to the hub, where Defoe Manor is open. I'm going to go ahead and save it one more time. Coming up on the end, although the end is pretty long. Will you three come with me into the hub? If that is what you order. We do only as we're told. How many of you are there? We don't know. When any of us fall, another comes here to take our place. So if you die, I can come back here and there'll be more of you? Until there are no more. Personally, I'm in no hurry to die. Come on. Okay. I'll add it to my journal. Lich. Also, Lich. A kind of undead sorcerer, granted immortality by removing their soul from their body and placing it in an external object. Voldemort! The Lich's body is indestructible. It can still be stretched, twisted, made to feel pain. But only damage to their soul artifact will cause permanent damage. Wraith, a servant of a Lich. A dead life form whose soul is placed post-mortem in a small part of the Lich's soul artifact, making them subservient. Wraiths are non-corporeal, and like all ghosts, can exert influence over environments and objects to which they are tied. It should be noted that the Wraith's influence and manifestations become increasingly wild and uncontrolled if its soul is separated from its mind. So, the Slender Man, the Tall Man, is a Lich, and John Defoe is a Wraith. So each trilby that you have here basically represents a step that you can take, like a room that you can move from one to another. I need to get all of John Defoe's artifacts before he flips out. So, and going back out here will reset it. Finale is so strange. I don't remember where all the stuff is. That's why I saved it, because I don't wanna. It hurts. Yes, it hurts. There's the apron. Now I just need to find his machete. Is. And interestingly, it's in the same place that the gun used to be. I do love that it came full circle. The game began and ends here. That the series did. Time to go. Father, it hurts. Should've. Father. Killed you. Demon. Demon. Demon child. It hurts. Father. Child. I saved him. Father. Demon child. I brought him back. No. Child. It hurts. Demon. 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 The bridge keeper. Please. Hold me. It hurts. The new prince. Know the name, Father, the King, the Prince, hold me, Janine, please, the Floating Man, Bridge Keeper, I killed the Floating Man, I killed Defoe, Defoe Manor. You were the last one? I think so. The others all went into the house. They never came out. Does that mean anything to you? Does that spark any memories? I think the others were killed. When I think that, images start to flash before my eyes. Defoe Manor being here feels wrong. I think it's supposed to have been destroyed. In what way destroyed? Fire. I supposed to have burned down. Perhaps you should address this inconsistency. Yes. How? I can show you where to get some petrol. I can feel something. It's like a flat metal surface above my head. I pushed as hard as I could, but it won't move. It's moving. Focus, DeKalb. It's not really happening. There's some kind of document lying on it. Children of the King, rejoice, for the time is finally at hand. Our patience, these last few centuries, will finally be rewarded. 200 years ago, the body of the Bridgekeeper was destroyed. 200 years from now, the soul of the Bridgekeeper will meet the same fate. These are known as the Bridge Events. Their significance was so great that they sent ripples of weakness through the timeline itself, echoing off in both the past and the future. On the 28th of July, 2189, the ripples from the past will collide with the ripples from the future, creating an area of extreme weakness between the two realms. If the third bridge event, the destruction of the mind, occurs at this point, the force of the explosion will penetrate that area of weakness and form the bridge between the realms. Over this bridge, the king, Jizo, will come. He will come to save us and all the men of technology from sin. We must, however, be alive to enjoy this new age of perfect purity. And so it is important that the complex and ophthalmology building be evacuated at least 1 week prior to the bridge event. Oh no. It's a bomb. There's enough nano explosive here to atomize the county. Nothing for it. I've got to try to disarm it. Wait a second. This bomb's already been defused. The prince was defusing the bomb? Shit! No. No! Don't think that's gonna help. Yep. There we go. Six days later. You're watching UCBC News. Investigations continue into the circumstances that resulted in a nano-explosive detonation in the county of Buckinghamshire 6 days ago. The blast completely demolished the ophthalmology building, which had been purposely evacuated beforehand, and several lead ophthalmologists are being held for questioning. Although the detonation has not yet been found to have caused any loss of life, two individuals last seen in the area have been reported missing. And environmentalists are already calling this the biggest ecological disaster in the entire history of the country. The investigation continues. As an avatar of destiny, I cannot judge. I cannot afford to question events, only encourage them to take place as history demands. And yet I wonder why the Order of Blessed Agonies expected Jizo to enter this universe. After all, a creature so dependent on magic could not possibly survive in a world where there is none. The prophecies were wrong. Freehorn, the Order, the Tall Man himself, all deliberately misled by the Pain Elemental. But why? For what purpose was the bridge really constructed? It was open for mere seconds. Nothing came through from the ethereal realm. So did Jizo's plan simply fail? Or was his attention not to send, but to receive? None of this matters. I led Dekab through the destiny demanded of him by the timeline. Now I must wait. 2 centuries from now, my younger self will require my guidance. The eternal cycle must be set in motion again. And while I do not judge and feel no regret, I find that I do not relish this task. In the 18th century, the prophet Jack Freehorn put to paper the 3 books of Jizo, the blood of the 12 sacrifices still fresh on his hands. The Book of the Prince, the Book of the Victims, and the Book of the Bridge. This is a central tenet in the faith of the Order of the Blessed Agonies. What is not known, not even by the highest acolytes, and likely not even by the prince himself, is that there was a 4th book. It seemed to contradict the other prophecies, and Freehorn discarded the draft, thinking it a garbled message. This was the book of the new prince. Here is what it said. One, the day of the bridge, the prince returned to the court of the king and bowed low before the presence. Two, and the king was greatly wrathful, and he said to the prince, "Why have you returned, O prince? You, who would betray his king, who would defy his own flesh?" Three, and with those words the king threw down the prince and stripped away his vestments. And the prince once again became the arrogant man. Four. And the arrogant man said, "I wanted only to please you, my king. I know you schemed to replace me, and if I betrayed you, it was only to remain your prince." Five. And the king replied, "I have not forgotten that you were once the arrogant man, and still your arrogance blinds you. Who are you to question my plans? You little man of linear time. Who are you to believe he knows what is best for I, who have drunk down the agonies of a million men. I, who was seen at the edge of forever. Who have seen the edge of forever. Six. You are not my prince, O arrogant man. You were never truly of my flesh. Seven. And the king gave the vestments of the prince, took the vestments and gave them to the man of purity, and the man of purity became the new prince. Eight. And the arrogant man wept aloud, "Why have you betrayed me, my king? What have I done that I should earn this wrath?" Nine. Came the reply, "Long ago, you were offered the chance to fulfill the role of the bridge, and as a being of both magic and technology. You could have proven your commitment to your king. You could have chosen your successor. But in your arrogance, you resisted and created the child to become the bridge in your stead. 10. And after you learned the true purpose of the bridge, you had the audacity to subvert my will. Weakly, you sought to avert your destiny and the destinies of others. 2. But 11. But rejoice, arrogant man, for I've provided another opportunity to fight your fate. Simply defeat your successor and return to my side. 12. The new prince faced the arrogant man. 12. And the new prince threw down the arrogant man. Apparently I'm the new prince. I forgot you control him at the end here. And there's Trilby. The guide. Take his place. My king. How the final Trilby ended up there. And the new prince, who we got a glimpse of earlier, is John Defoe. And the arrogant man knew the name of the king, the Book of the New Prince. There we go. So, yeah, that ending is a little bit confusing, but basically, John Defoe was, he was purified through mind, body, and soul to become the bridge. And so, basically, Jizo had intended for, basically, Jizo had intended for, the tall man to be the bridge in the first place. And the tall man didn't want that. He wanted power. He wanted to stay, he wanted to be the prince. But the, but Jizo basically, I guess basically what ended up happening is that, when the prince realized what, Jizo actually had intended for him, he became jealous. And the reason that he started killing the Trilbies was to try to subvert the plans of Jizo. And why he disarmed the bomb there at the end. So, basically, yeah, it all came around full circle. But, and interestingly enough, Jizo never intended to cross over. He wanted, what he wanted from the very beginning was a servant. Like a perfect servant, I guess, either as an avatar or a successor. I'm not really sure on that part, but, yeah. So that's how that goes. And, the old man Trilby was actually the final clone who got taken there at the end along with, Defoe. And then the original Trilby, I guess, after, you know, the events of Trilby's Notes, just got to live out his normal life. So, I guess, happy ending for Trilby. But, Malcolm Somerset's life was not that great. He ended up killing himself. Which is the door. I love that part where the door, the wall of flesh is actually his own throat. It's like symbolic. And then you see him going back through all the murders on the Mephistopheles, but everyone that he's killing is John Defoe over and over again. And as he's becoming more and more, becoming the guide. And then he was trapped by fate. And I mean, I feel a little bit bad for him, but at the same time, he did kill his father, and as when he's talking to his the guide, when he comes back and is talking to him from the future, the guide does say, you know, you intended to do it, I just pushed you in that direction. So, I mean, I guess you can't really, you know, I guess you can't really feel bad for Malcolm, but, I don't know, just fantastic series. And, I don't know. I'm gonna play through, whatchamacallit, the two side games, the two spin-offs, which are, Trilby the Art of Theft, and I want to say The Lurking Darkness is the name of the other one. It's something close to that anyway. But, basically, the one is a horror game, but it's only loosely tied to this one. Let me look up the name real quick. I don't want to give you the wrong name. Trilby the Art of Theft is not a horror game. I'm gonna play it on here anyway, just because it's like a spin-off of the series, and it's kind of cool to see that as well. But here we go. It's called The Consuming Shadow. I'm getting it confused with The Lurking Horror, which was an old Infocom game, which is also pretty good. But yeah, so The Consuming Shadow is the other spin-off. So if you have a chance to play it, I've seen previews of it and stuff, and it looks really cool. And Yahtzee's games are always amazing, so you should go download it. Anyway, that is the end of the Jizo mythos, though. All the main games in the series. So, I'm not exactly sure what I'm going to do next. Hopefully, I'm going to be putting up the audiobooks audiobook version of Ambuscade pretty soon, so look forward to that. In the meantime, please like and subscribe. If you would like to put any comments down in the comment section, it would be greatly appreciated. And until next time, remember that a mind is a terrible thing. Thank you so much.